So I'd first of all like to begin by inviting Rieke van der Graaf to come up, and she's going to talk about current international ethics guidance and regulations on the use of alternative research designs.
I have been asked by Adrian to provide an overview of current international ethical guidance and regulations on the use of alternative research designs. And it's not to say that I'm some sort of authority who's knowledgeable about all the guidance and regulations, but I've been asked to do it, and then I first thought, oh, she's testing me, because there's so little guidance. And I have been involved in the revision of the SEOMS working, I've been the secretary to the revision of the SEOMS guidelines. So I know a little of ethical guidelines. I know some of ethical guidance on alternative trial designs, but not that much. But what I found, I will present to you, and I hope it's of use when thinking what further steps need to be taken. So I will basically discuss international ethical guidance and regulation on the topics that we discussed in during this session. There might be more. So what I ignore, for instance, are FDA working documents, EMA working documents on adaptive trial designs, because we focus particularly on adaptive platforms, and there is more on alternative trial designs, but I try to confine it to the four topics discussed. So first, cluster randomized trials. There are two documents that play a key role in the discussion on ethics of CRTs. So the Ottawa Statement and the SEOMS document, and as you know, Charles Weyer is the first author of this Ottawa Statement. And I must say, it's a very impressive document in terms of content and influence. At least it is a key document in the literature, and also in discussions in research ethics committees. And I must say, I never understood how they did it, but they managed to get a position statement in trials, in the Journal of Trials, and also a series of background papers to the ethics issues identified in their project, which is very impressive and helpful if you are looking for explanations of the ethics issues identified in the ethics of CRTs. And the other document is the SEOMS guidelines document. So SEOMS already had some guidance on CRTs in the 2009 Blue Book on Epidemiological Studies. And so the 2016 version of the SEOMS guidelines is a merged version of the 2002 SEOMS guidelines on human subjects research and the Epidemiological Blue Book. So we now have an entire guideline on CRTs. This is an overview of the principles in the Ottawa Statement, and it's, I think, pretty much unreadable. But I thought it is good to mention at least this table, because I think it's helpful if you're doing review of CRTs, and at least the relevant principles are mentioned. So the justification of the cluster randomized trial design, research ethics review, identifying research participants, obtaining informed consent, gatekeeping, assessing harms and benefits, and protecting vulnerable participants. And there are detailed recommendations already in this table how to explain those more general principles. And of course, I recommend you to read the entire paper, which and the background papers that help you to understand what the authors meant with those principles. Now, in the SEAMS guidelines, and there's an entire guideline called Guideline 21 on cluster randomized trials, we have some similar principles, actually. So, and the SEAMS guidelines work from the idea that we are focused on some general ethical principles, like assessing harms and benefits. And then we say, okay, the same ethical principles should apply throughout the guidelines. And this particular guideline on CRTs focuses on issues that are specific for CRTs. So who is the research participant is different, which is not always the case in a regular RCT, but here you have to think also of healthcare workers who can be research participants, and when is the participant the direct or the indirect target of your research intervention. Is informed consent feasible and required, and from whom? Whether informed consent invalidates results, the ethical acceptability of a no intervention group, in particular in low resource settings, and gatekeeping. So those are the issues that have been highlighted in the SEAMS guidelines. And if you compare then SEAMS to Ottawa, I must say that I couldn't find any really different issues. So the justification of the CRT, which is being stressed in Ottawa, is also part of the SEAMS guidelines, but then in another guideline. So in guideline 5, we talk about the choice of control, and there we say the RCT is the gold standard, and you have to justify alternative trial designs. Independent ethics review, the entire SEAMS document is directed at research ethics committees and what they must do and must not do. So yes, it is important, but not there. We didn't see any specific issues that had to be related in relation to CRTs. Identifying who's the research participant, that's similar. Obtaining informed consent, the issues that are at stake are similar. Role of gatekeepers, also assessing harms and benefits, that's part of guideline 4, where we address risk-benefit assessment. But what we thought is in particular of particular importance is withholding the proven effective intervention or the delayed rolled out discussion that we had yesterday. And protection of vulnerable participants is part of guideline 15. So I think what we can say is that there are two differences. The status is different. Ottawa is a position statement, and SEAMS is international ethical guidance. And the focus is different since Ottawa focused on the ethics of CRTs as a whole, whereas SEAMS focused on what is different in CRTs. But more or less, I would say they are the same. I've also looked at challenges or open issues on the ethics of CRTs, and I remember long discussions in our working group about the question to what extent specific guidance is needed for CRTs. Why do we have to include a new guideline? Because the exact same principles are underlying our discussions. And at the same time, there were many open issues in the specification process of those more general principles. So we ended up with a guideline. I think another open issue is that both documents actually give limited guidance on specific protection needed in CRTs, in LMICs, well, if at all. So that's also an open issue. Do we need specific guidance? If there are morally relevant differences, do we need then specific guidance for our LMIC research? The second issue, step-wedge CRTs, because there are forms of cluster randomized trials, there's indirect guidance in the Ottawa statement and in the SEAMS document, so we don't need specific guidance. Nonetheless, if you look at the ethics issues raised in papers, and there's also no other document than the Ottawa statement and the SEAMS guidelines, who both do not elaborate on specifics of step-wedge trial designs. But if you look at the papers, the most recent papers now in the forms of reports or reviews, then you see issues that guidance committees might find of interest. For instance, another paper published by the group of Charles Weyer, so Monica Talliard is the first author here, and we discussed it yesterday as well, is that it's not always seen as research, so there's not always research at a review taking place, and informed consent in her study was reported in 50% of the cases. I did analysis from different perspectives within my research group as well, and we found that in particular issues of informed consent, clinical equipoise, and social value are relevant or different or in need of guidance. We talked about it yesterday. So is it research or implementation or evaluation? Is evaluation still research? So that's an open issue. Clinical equipoise and informed consent, as in, should we be specifically concerned about violation of informed consent? Are CRTs different in terms of waiving informed consent or modifying informed consent than other studies where we also use waivers or modifications of informed consent? And do we need to be specifically worried about special protection issues in NMIC research, in step wedge designs used in NMICs? So platform trials, there's no guidance and no regulation, simple one. But I thought perhaps the review article recently published in the New England Journal of Medicine might function for research ethics committees as a guide when they have to review those master protocols. They are looking for papers in at least in my committee, we are looking for papers like papers published in big journals to give some guidance. So that New England Journal paper might function in a way as giving guidance to RECs. It's also in the bundle of literature that was advised for or recommended for this meeting. And I deduced some issues that RECs might take up. So the paper says that upfront planning due to more complex designs and real decision making is an issue. And then I thought, okay, so a research ethics committee might wonder, when are these trials so complex that the REC should be concerned? Do they have sufficient expertise? And do they have to think of new models of review, so pre-review, before the study is being conducted, or staged review? Might be issues that can come across in a research ethics committee. Then there is another paragraph in that paper stating that as new drugs are approved for marketing, the standard of care and clinical practice can change. That an advantage might be that the trial is can be redesigned, and that can be an advantage compared to a standalone trial. But then the paper says marketplace changes can negatively affect protocols. So, and then I deduced those issues that they raised as issues for RECs to consider, because it can affect the protocols in a temporary hold in recruitment, changes in the statistical analysis plan, and also a temporary hold in the ability to attract new therapies when a more effective standard of care becomes the comparator. So might be issues that a REC may want to discuss. And a third issue is that master protocols can last many years, even decades. So I thought, so there might be implications for informed consent. We may want to think of more dynamic forms of informed consent. Can you give one-time informed consent for a study with no endpoint? So how does it work? And I think it might be something that an ethical committee may want to consider. Then the CHIMS. Catherine is going to talk about it in more detail, but I will mention two reports here. There's the WHO report, human challenge trials for vaccine development, so regulatory considerations, and the paper mentioned already by this morning of Gordon and colleagues, a framework for controlled human infection model studies in Malawi, and that's the report of the Wellcome Trust workshop on CHIMS in LMICs held in Malawi. Now, the WHO report has a specific section on ethics, but I went through the whole document, and then I thought there are at least three other issues that, from an ethics perspective, I would also think are relevant. And the first issue is whether or not these CHIMS studies are subjected to regulations. The document says it's important to consider the regulatory framework in which the human challenge trial may be conducted, because in some countries, challenge stocks are expected to be regulated in the same manner as vaccines and are to be expected to be studied with authorization in accordance with clinical trial regulations, whether or not an investigational vaccine is to be used in the same clinical investigation protocol. So in some countries or in some, according to some regulations, it might be subjected might be similar to vaccine studies, and in other cases it might not be. The social and scientific value is being emphasized in the report, because it says the purpose of the study would influence the design, which would in turn influence conclusions and decisions that might be made from the study results by regulators. So I think an issue for RECs to consider, and then LMIC specific, and that's more or less in line with what Pai Kyong already stressed this morning. It should be noted that human challenge trials have been and can be successfully conducted in LMICs. The same standards would apply as in more developed countries. Now, they do have this ethics paragraph, it's more a long story, so I deduced some issues. They talk about minimizing risks and maximizing benefits, and then they say, well, consider potential individual risks and benefits and potential societal benefits and risks, such as release into the environment of a pathogen that might not otherwise be present. So that's sort of basic risk benefit assessment. But what might be more specific is that you have to minimize risk to subjects in clinical trials, and that calls for investigators to give due considerations to whether or not the challenge organism needs be pathogenic or not, or to what degree. And then third, participants should not be just informed, but truly informed. And I don't know if that's different from genuine informed consent, but, well, you have to give true informed consent, which includes at least that you have to be informed about the risks, which might be greater than minimal, and whether they receive a vaccine that will or will not protect them from the challenge organism, a placebo that will not protect them, or only the challenge organism itself. Now, in the complexity of the risks in this informed consent process leads WHO to say that the trials cannot be conducted in children and in competence, except if the challenge organism is a licensed live attenuated vaccine. And independent ethics review is needed as well. Now on the framework published by Corden and colleagues. Here also the claim is international standards for consent do not vary, but means of information provision and of gaining a response are different in many low and middle income countries. Consultation with communities and locally experienced researchers is important. So you have to determine a balance between incentivized research, where there's too much perceived benefit, and the lack of appropriate compensation for the negative impact on earnings and opportunity costs for participants, so too little remuneration. Local RECs should be encouraged to develop relationships with CHIM-experienced RECs to seek advice and share experiences. And then this framework also mentions specific legal and regulatory issues. It also emphasizes that regulatory issues might differ between countries, and that legal positions vary substantially and may include even the Department of Agriculture and Environment. So you may not have to submit your protocol to what we are probably all used to, the regular REC in your medical department, but you may have to turn to the Department of Agriculture and Environment. Another worry is that it's not always classified as pharmaceutical products, so different regulations might apply. And here's the figure that was shown before by Mariel as well. So this report has the nice advantage, I would say, that the ethical acceptability is centered in the middle. The ethical acceptability then depends on a range of factors, so national importance, capacity development, strong scientific case, the quality, the governance, and safety. So my conclusions is that there is limited international guidance and regulation on alternative trial designs. There's apart from the Gordon report, there's just scarce guidance for LMICs. I think there are really open issues, open ethical issues that have to be discussed. And there's growing interest in the use of alternative methods and designs. So adding up, I would say there's a need for international and LMIC-specific ethical guidance on the use of alternative research designs, and for the uptake of such reports or guidance documents that come out of these discussions, it's crucially the uptake is crucially dependent on international organizations for assisting in writing and issuing these documents. So, an open question.